Ghana's finance minister Seth Terkper says the government is aiming to repeat the country's record of competitive but peaceful elections with a smooth transition. The West African nation revised its 2017 GDP growth forecast to between 7 and 7.4% from above 8% previously. Seth Terkper, Ghana's finance minister, joined me to share his insight into the build-up to the December 7 elections. Minister Terkper, thank you very much for speaking to us today. There's so much we can get through in this interview, but I just want to start, first of all, by just getting your perspective on the build-up to the December 7 elections. Typically in Africa, people tend to be very concerned about potential change in government. What's your perspective on the build-up this year, and is there any reason for investors to be concerned right now?
The record, you know, speaks for itself, and that is what we are aiming to do. That is what His Excellency the President, the Council, the other candidates, civil society, you know, and all, you know, who is Ghana well, Ghanaians and non-Ghanaians, you know, are hoping that we will repeat, which is a competitive but peaceful election, and a transition that is normally smooth, both in terms of politics, but more importantly, you know, on the economic front. Just to illustrate, last week I was in Parliament with my team after cabinet approval to move a vote in advance of appropriation under Article 180 of the Constitution. And that is because even though we read the budget in November, it is often very difficult to do so in an election year. And so for the third election cycle running, we go to Parliament with a vote in advance of the appropriation, which should have come at the end of the budget cycle, to make a request, you know, for 3 months for permission for the Minister of Finance under the authority of Cabinet to make withdrawals from the Consolidated Fund for 3 months, January to March, to keep government running until a handover. So the Constitution caters for not just political transitions, as have been seen, but it caters for any eventuality that can be imagined, from the use of oil, sorry, our revenue resources, through to making sure that such gaps do not result in uncertainty, you know, by investors. The debate was lively, but in the end, we got a vote, you know, by simple majority, by voice vote. So I just want to use this opportunity to assure investors that Ghana has everything to go for it in terms of smooth elections. And that is, you know, the goal of the Electoral Commission, you know, the candidates and Ghanaians in general.
But let's now move on to the budget. And starting with the 2016 budget, as you rightly mentioned, you did make that presentation to Parliament last week. One of the outcomes was that so far the government has missed many of its revenue targets and also have overshot in terms of the expenditure targets. And the big question is, over the rest of this year, given that it's an election year, many will suggest that it's possible that you would even overshoot more on the expenditure side. What's your message on that point?
No, I think that we need to put things in proper perspective. The expenditures are within the program targets. They are within the government as well as the IMF program targets. What we are missing is revenues, as you rightly pointed out, which is attributed mainly to the two factors. First of all, the decline in oil prices, which is affecting not just Ghana, modest as our production of oil in relation to Nigeria or to Angola is, it still makes a difference to our budget. So the oil prices is one factor. But the immediate factor is the a little damage that occurred to the FPSO, the drillship that produces crude oil, about 100,000 barrels of crude oil, during the first 5 months, you know, of the year. That has been resolved, and it's our expectation, you know, that the corrective measures that we have made, and I think the emphasis is on corrective measures, The first one is to go back to Parliament, despite an election year, to revise the expenditures downwards in anticipation of a lower oil revenue. And this is the second year running that we have done that. We did that earlier in the year when we did a mid-year review. And then secondly, the Jubilee partners, that is the partners mainly Talo, Cosmos, and Adaco, you know, have found, you know, some resolution, temporary resolution to the turret bearing of the FPSO, and therefore the FPSO is coming back, you know, stream and producing some crude oil as well as gas. But I think both in terms of making up, you know, and also in terms of prospects, I think you are aware that the president commissioned the Tenfield FPSO, which has also started production. And so the records that you are talking about was up to the end of August. And so we are expecting, you know, to recover somewhat from the revenue shortfalls. And given the adjustments that we have in the IMF program, we hope to end the year. Yes, you are right about the concern that investors have, you know, with election year expenditure. And this is one of the issues that we do really have for the in our program to make sure that, you know, the we keep expenditures, you know, within the program, you know, target. We were on a roadshow recently and we did explain, you know, this issue to investors. That is another important thing to keep abreast, you know, with those investors anytime there are developments, in order that this development in particular, in as much as it's external and exogenous, cannot be blamed, you know, on the normal election year, you know, expenditures.
I have read that the forecast for GDP growth next year is 8%. That sounds like a really, very, really good number. The big question is how likely that is, and what really is going to drive that? Your broad expectations for growth next year and the key drivers.
Yes, thank you very much. I think that figure has been revised slightly downwards, but it is still robust. We are estimating, you know, growth between 7.4%, which is still, you know, robust, as you said. I think that even during the period of austerity, when we launched the homegrown policy first and then the IMF program, we kept saying that some of the setbacks that the economy was going through were temporary. Temporary in the sense that the main one was a 2.5 years disruption in gas supply, which affected not just Ghana, but Benin, Cote d'Ivoire, as well as Togo, from the disruption, the damage to the West Africa gas pipeline. That has been restored. We know that we do still have some challenges, both with respect to the supply and the putting the finances right for the West Africa gas pipeline, and we're in discussions on that. But you also are aware of the simultaneous fall in gold, in our case, gold, cocoa, and then, as I just mentioned, crude oil price. So the economy went through quite a number of setbacks. And then our growth started to decline. Any economy going through shocks, you know, would go through some of this decline, as is evidenced not just in Africa, not just in Ghana, but Africa as well as, you know, elsewhere, you know, on the globe. But even then, we kept pointing to investments that Ghana was making, which suggests, you know, bright prospects, you know, for the economy. First of all, we kept pointing to the fact that the services sector remained, you know, robust. I think a lot of people associate Ghana with agriculture and natural resources, which is true. But the largest sector of our economy is the services sector, which has been picking up. And we saw both for construction, private sector in particular, and for the for the services sector, that growth was healthy. In our previous segment discussion, I did mention some major developments in oil and gas. You'll recall that we took a facility to construct the gas plant to take on gas from the Jubilee field, which I said was one of the reasons for the slowdown at the beginning of this year, particularly of revenue. We also said that, you know, by this year, and we were slightly ahead of schedule, the 10-field FPSO, which suffered a temporary setback with the court case, would come on stream. That has come on stream. But the big one is the Sankofa field. The Sankofa field, which together with the 10-field and the Jubilee, will bring nearly 3 trillion cubic feet of gas, you know, on stream. We'll see additional production of crude. Estimates are put between 80,000 to 100,000 barrels, you know, per day, on top of what we are doing. So bringing Ghana's oil production to probably between 180 to 200,000. We were very intense and keen on making sure that, you know, these investments come on stream with all the support that we could give to the private sector. That led to our partnership with the World Bank and the partial risk guarantee, you know, which the World Bank, you know, approved, and for which we gave the indemnity. Those who were monitoring the IMF World Bank programs, annual meetings would note that the World Bank president in the plenary mentioned this particular program guarantee as having very good prospects for the economy. So your first source, you know, in essence, is oil and gas. We are moving away from associated gas to associated crude, and harnessing the gas through this guarantee and independent power production is the immediate cause of the growth. But Ghana also having, you know, chemicals such as salt, as well as petroleum byproducts, is expecting, you know, to harness these same resources, you know, for boosting agriculture and as well as other sectors of the economy through, for example, production of fertilizer as well as, you know, bitumen. And so we expect to continue the value addition and diversification by harnessing the downstream, midstream and downstream of the petroleum sector, not just the upstream, you know, to support, you know, the growth that we're talking about. Ghana is also looking to enhance, you know, the services sector, which currently is focused on financial services, transportation services, and education, health, and others, to add oil and gas, you know, services, in other words, energy services, in order that the energy sector would continue to grow. The advances into fertilizer in particular would also enable the agriculture sector to come back, you know, very strong. So these are the, if you like, the sources as well as the strategies that we are trying to follow through various investments, both public and private sector, to boost the economy, which is resulting in the figures that you see, growth of 7% to 8.5, some put it at 9% between 2017 and 2018. By the way, we are continuing with the stability, stabilization program under the IMF, the consolidation. The unique thing about this IMF program, the current one, unlike previous ones, although there was one previously with a slight overlap, is that the IMF program covers the election year. The IMF program extends, you know, into 2017, 2018, you know, and therefore we like to see the economy as moving from a stabilization or consolidation phases, if you like, into a growth phase. And we believe that the GDP growth you are saying, you were talking about, would also address one very important concern about the Ghanaian economy, which is that with the hippic space that we had, you know, Ghana occupied the space with some borrowing. We have been able to control that borrowing, slow down the rate of growth of borrowing, And at the moment, we are seeing a slight decline in the debt to GDP ratio, based mainly on efforts on the numerator. But if you have GDP growth, then we expect, you know, that the debt to GDP ratio would also, you know, decline and bring Ghana back to the B plus ratings, you know, circle where it used to be.
That was Ghana's Finance Minister, Seth Terkper. As we continue our conversation on Ghana's economy ahead of the December elections, my guest is Seth Terkper, Ghana's Finance Minister. Minister, you were making a point about the programs around the power sector. I'll allow you to just finish that point before we move on to other issues.
We should not view power just in terms of, you know, the difficulties that the economy has gone through, particularly with the disruption in gas supply. But we should view power also in terms of, you know, bringing the gas on stream to power industry and therefore rehabilitating industry, but also industry contributing, particularly with the export-led strategy that we are trying to follow through the establishment of the Exim Bank, you know, to a healthy contribution from particularly agribusiness, you know, to the growth story that we are talking about.
And these growth prospects seem really good on paper. But as the opposition leader, Nana Akufo-Addo, he has made a point about the government not being sensitive enough to the needs of the Ghanaian people. We know that quite a few are still quite poor. And the big question is, when would this all this growth translate into a significant change in the life, or the lifestyle rather, of Ghanaians?
Well, we disagree with that assertion. Because even under the IMF program, we made sure that we catered for social intervention programs, and these are part of the conditions of the IMF program. Releases for what we call the LEAP, you know, project, releases that we make, you know, to the statutory funds. So these statutory funds are very important, and government is aligning the objectives of the statutory funds, particularly the education fund, you know, the health fund, and the District Assembly's Common Fund, which is a rural development or sub-national government fund, aligning their objectives mainly to social intervention. So through these programs, we are looking at school feeding, for example, with school uniforms. We are looking at subsidies that are usually, you know, paid to, which were classified as subsidies, but shifted, you know, to realigning the objectives. We still do have the lifeline for electricity and water consumption. So we do have, I would entreat, you know, the opposition to look critically at the government, you know, program, you know, both in respect of the homegrown and the way we are using the statutory funds to address. For example, much of the work that is being done, for example, rural roads, primary schools and others, you know, are all, you know, things which go to contributes directly and indirectly to. So we have a very healthy social intervention program.
All right, let's move on to another point, and that is the CD. It's been relatively stable over the last few months after the IMF program was completed. The big question is what happens going forward? And what do you say to investors today who are looking at the CD and maybe are still quite concerned? What's your outlook for the currency?
I think a slight correction there. The CD stabilization did not start with the completion of the IMF program. In fact, the CD, anybody would tell you that the CD has been stable. Even the most difficult periods for the CD is the period from November, December through April, May, before we enter the cocoa season. But even during this year, the CD has been relatively stable during those periods. I think it comes down to strategy, how we utilize foreign exchange that we get, how we harness, you know, those, you know, foreign exchange and Bank of Ghana's, you know, management, you know, of, you know, the resources that come in and the mobilization of resources. Of course, it has also been helped, you know, by certain factors, even though it saw some setback, you know, like the additional revenue from crude oil and the rest. And this is something which we want to continue, particularly with the better prospects from Tenfield, and from the Sankofa going forward to make sure that we have a very, effective management, of the external side of the economy, as well as in inflation and interest rates by the central bank to complement, the fiscal, some of the fiscal measures that we've been talking about.
Right, but what's the outlook for the city? What do you expect next year?
Bank of Ghana expects, the outlook to be within what was, announced. Already we are entering into one of the peak periods for demand for the city. But as you know, Cocoa Ball just did its bond, which is the main source of supply, for the city. As I said, the setbacks from the export of crude oil in particular, which affected not just revenue, but foreign, some correction has also been done. And then we are going to see the exports coming with the TEM field. In other words, the sources of foreign exchange itself, is diversifying. But we do not want to leave it just that. As I mentioned earlier on, government just launched an export-led, strategy that would establish, consolidate some institutions that we have into an Exim Bank, which act has just been passed, the board has been appointed. And the idea is to make sure that export credit and export, guarantee are available following the Cocoa Board model, whereby export earnings will be escrowed for purposes of more competitive finance, particularly for the private sector. And we believe that this, would help to help the, this would help, the strategies that we have been implementing over the last, 1 year, going to the next 2-3 years,
yep.
To stabilize, yep. The sources of supply of Forex in the city.
As I begin to round up, I just want us to reflect on the recent dollar bond issue. Very successful issue. And the big question is whether or not this will be the first of many. It sounds like potentially a new strategy to raise not just dollars, but to raise funds for the government.
Yes, Ghana moved into zero central bank financing for the budget. And for that reason, the Minister of Finance, is looking at various ways to tap, resources. But we are very mindful that this does not affect the banking sector, crowding private sector. And therefore, it is being done under certain very, strict, rules. But there is still, as you rightly said, there's a potential of Forex, which individuals as well as institutions are holding. Ghana has a retention policy, for example, for the private sector to retain their Forex earnings. Some of these earnings are, in domestic banks and they lie in deposit accounts. So what the government is doing is to mobilize this. But we want to be very strategic with the mobilization. As you know, Ghana just started a buyback of its bonds to avoid the rollover risk,
yep.
which we try to avoid very hard. And therefore, these are going to be channeled mainly, to support the buyback, when our bonds are trading well, either for a risk launch or for a cancellation. And then our oil revenues that is going into the sinking fund, will be used instead to pay, for the bonds. For the bonds that we are issuing. In other words, borrow cheap, to take off very expensive, bonds, and then you make, some headroom, and then through the sinking fund, you are able to pay back. We don't intend that these bonds continue to add, but they perform a very important role, I agree with you, because refinancing, or meeting our maturities is a very key element, of the budget and the financing. So we are looking forward to we'll do an evaluation. We'll look at its impact on the fiscal, on the banking sector. We are going to do this with the central bank, and then continue. There is a possibility that we may use it to tap or reach out to Ghanaians who are outside, who can give government money and earn a healthy 5% instead of some of the depressed rates, that are out there, in the diaspora, if I have to use the word.
And that was Ghana's finance minister, Seth Terkper.